At the end of this video, you might not understand what entropy is, and that's perfectly fine. You might pass your first thermodynamics course with flying colors and not understand what entropy is, and that's also fine. The main goal of this video is to help you understand how to solve problems you might encounter when it comes to entropy and what equations you'll likely need for most questions. So keeping that in mind, let's try our best to get an idea for what entropy is and what the increase in entropy principle is. It's a really useful property that helps us understand processes, devices, and things we see all the time. It allows us to understand why processes happen in a certain direction. For example, imagine you take a cup of hot coffee in your hand and hold it. What if your hand got colder and the cup got even hotter? In other words, the heat from your hand was transferred to the cup. We would be surprised, to say the least, but for this system, the conservation of energy was still maintained, just like when your hand gets hotter while the coffee gets cooler. That means changes in energy within a closed system do not set the direction of irreversible processes. This direction of energy transfer is set by something called the change in entropy. You can think of entropy as molecular disorder or the randomness of molecules. When a system becomes disordered, the molecules become less and less predictable, and we say entropy increases. That means entropy is lowest in the solid phase of a substance and highest in the gas phase. In a closed system with an irreversible process, so everything that happens in nature, the entropy of the system will always increase. It never decreases. In a reversible process, the change in entropy stays constant. What this means is that entropy does not obey a law of conservation. Remember, energy is always conserved in a closed system, but entropy just keeps increasing. This is why entropy is sometimes called the arrow of time. For example, when we see an ice cube melting in a hot room, we associate that with the forward direction of time with an increase in entropy. If the ice cube slowly went back to its original self, then the entropy would decrease, so it never happens. This change in entropy, denoted with the capital letter S, can be found using this equation. The integral version of it looks like this. This is the entropy of the first state, and this is the entropy of the second state. When you solve problems, you can assign a value of 0 at some arbitrarily selected reference state and then figure out the entropy of the second state. In the integral, Q is the heat supplied to the system or heat transfers from the system, and T is the temperature of the system in kelvins. From this equation, we can see that entropy change is based not only on energy transferred as heat, but also the temperature at which the transfer takes place. Most of the time, this integral equation is rarely used, and you will end up using values from charts. These equations have the units joules per Kelvin. In certain cases, where we have isothermal heat transfer processes, so that means the temperature doesn't change, we can simplify the equation to this. Here, T0 is the constant temperature of the system, and Q is the heat transfer. This equation is helpful whenever you need to figure out entropy changes in thermal energy reservoirs. For example, if we have QH and TH, then it would look like this. If we had QL and TL, it would look like this. It works even in rate form. It's an incredibly useful equation whenever we deal with thermal reservoirs and entropy. Keep in mind that if heat is transferred to a system, entropy of the system increases. And if heat is transferred from a system, then the entropy of the system decreases. Whenever an irreversible process occurs, there is some entropy generated. This is due to irreversibilities. So remember, those were things like friction, chemical reactions, deformations, etc. We use a capital letter S with a subscript GEN to represent the entropy generated during an irreversible process. When we account for this, our equation looks like this. The entropy generated is always positive in irreversible processes and 0 in reversible processes. This value gives us insight as to the magnitudes of irreversibilities present during a process. All of this goes back to what we said before, which is entropy always increases in actual processes, and in reversible processes, it stays constant. This is called the increase of entropy principle. That's enough background to solve problems when it comes to increase in entropy. In the future videos, we will cover more and more subsections related to entropy, and you should gain a better idea of it. For now, let's get to some examples. Let's take a look at this problem where we have heat transferred from a hot reservoir to a cold reservoir. We need to figure out the entropy change of both reservoirs. Let's start by writing down what we know. 100 kilojoules of heat is transferred to the cold reservoir. The hot reservoir has a temperature of 1200 Kelvin, and the cold reservoir has a temperature of 600 Kelvin. Let's focus on the hot reservoir first and figure out its entropy change. For that, we can use this equation. So for the hot reservoir, it transfers 100 kilojoules of energy. You can think of it as losing 100 kilojoules of energy, so our QH is negative. Solving gives us the change in entropy for the hot reservoir. For the cold reservoir, we use the same equation. This time, the cold reservoir gains 100 kilojoules of heat, so it's positive. Solving gives us the change in entropy for the cold reservoir. The total change is the addition of both of these values. We get a positive value, so entropy of everything increased during this process. Let's take a look at this problem involving a reversible heat pump. We need to find the rate of entropy change in the cold and hot reservoirs. Let's start by writing down what we know. The heat pump produces 300 kilowatts of power, so that's our QH. The house is at 24 degrees Celsius, which is our TH, and the outside air is at 7 degrees Celsius, which is our TL. Since we have QH and TH, we can easily figure out the entropy change in the hot reservoir. In this case, the house. Let's plug our values in and solve for the entropy change. Now to find the entropy change in the outside air, we need to figure out QL. To figure that out, we first need to figure out the COP of this heat pump. For that, we can use this equation. This should be familiar to you from the previous video about Carnot heat pumps. Solving gives us the COP. Now using this COP value, we can figure out the amount of power needed to run this heat pump. Remember, COP is just desired output divided by the required input. This should be familiar to you from the heat pumps video. Let's plug in our values. Now we can solve. We can finally get our QL by using this equation, which says the network is the difference between QH and QL. Plugging in our values and solving gives us our QL. Now we can calculate the change in entropy. Let's plug in our values, but keep in mind that the cold reservoir is losing 282 kilowatts of energy, so it's negative. Let's solve, and that gives us the entropy change of the cold reservoir. If you add these two values up, you will notice that you get zero for the total entropy change. That makes sense, since this heat pump is completely reversible, and entropy change for reversible processes is zero. Let's take a look at this problem, where we have to find the entropy change of a Carnot cycle. Let's start by writing down what we know. 900 kilojoules of heat is added to the working fluid from a source at 400 degrees Celsius. So that's our Q and T values. The first part of the question wants us to figure out the entropy change of the working fluid. So we know that our source added 900 kilojoules of energy. In other words, the working fluid gained 900 kilojoules of energy. So using this equation, we can write it like this. Remember that in Carnot cycles, the heat transferred from the source will be equal to the heat transferred to the working fluid. In simple terms, they both will have the same temperature. Let's solve. Next, we need to find the entropy change of the source. When we look at the source, it lost 900 kilojoules of energy, so it'll be negative. The last part wants us to figure out the total change in entropy. That's the addition of both of these values. We get zero, and that makes sense. A Carnot cycle is a fully reversible cycle, so the entropy change would be zero. That should cover the types of problems you will face when it comes to the increase in entropy principle. Thanks for watching, and best of luck with your studies.